The Spinoff Podcast Network.
K-pop to me means more than just listening to music. It's learning to be myself.
The Spinoff's new documentary, K-Polys, follows three Pacific youth obsessed with K-pop. In a one-off documentary, see what they've found in Korean pop culture and how they bridge it with their own.
When you start dressing, looking different, everyone side-eyes you. But in K-pop, they're just like, no, like, celebrate yourself.
Watch K-Polys today at thespinoff.co.nz/videos. Made with the support of New Zealand On Air. You're listening to Business is Boring, a podcast that reckons it's anything but. Business is Boring is brought to you by Spark Lab, offering inspiration and practical advice to help businesses find their edge. To hear more about Spark Lab, including details about the latest events, workshops, and business tools, visit sparklab.co.nz. And now, here's your host, Simon Pound.
You're listening to Business is Boring, a podcast that reckons it's anything but. Business is Boring is made by The Spinoff with help from Callaghan Innovation, New Zealand's innovation agency. Here's your host, Simon Pound.
2018 can feel quite progressive and doing pretty well, if you're in the right bubble. But in many ways, oh boy, there's still a lot of work to do. Like with tampons and pads. Half the population needs them, yet they are mainly made with synthetic and potentially harmful materials and have attached to them in some places luxury taxes and in many places a stigma around them. Which is where the organic initiative comes in, to provide an organic alternative and foster the movement to recognise safety and health around periods. It's a radically sustainable and progressive company, co-founded by today's guest just a few short years ago. Helen Robinson is a wildly accomplished founder of a startup, having been CEO at Microsoft New Zealand in some of its most dominant days, a board member of nationally and globally significant bodies like ATEED, and a winner of the Supreme Award at the Women of Influence Awards. To talk the journey and the mission, Helen joins us by Skype from America, where she is with Oi. G'day, thank you for joining us.
Hi Simon, it's good to be here.
Hey, so let's start with the early career. You started a tech company really young and then in quite a short time was CEO at Microsoft at a time where, you know, in today's landscape, it might be hard to really understand for some people just how dominant and concentrated the influence was in the big names like Microsoft. Tell me about that journey. What did you learn from starting things?
I guess I've always been involved in startups and wild and fabulous ideas, if you like. So really from a business standpoint, as opposed from a technology perspective, I've kind of fell into the tech sector. I ended up the equivalent of what's today a CIO. So was a DP manager at a very young age for a group of companies and loved technology. And not from a technology, you know, from a technical perspective, but very much from a technology application. You know, what does this do for us in the way in which we live, way in which we work? And I have to say, you know, they're pretty fabulous days in the tech sector, you know, the 80s and 90s, early 2000s, where, you know, there weren't huge numbers of players, but there were huge players. And they really did dominate the market. And I think it taught me anyone can do anything at a scale level. And, you know, you can still be a small company, but still do have enormous reach, you know, miles out. And you know, a vision like what, you know, Bill Gates had, really, you know, PC on every desk. You know, it's a wild vision. And probably everybody thought that was just ridiculous. But, you know, anybody really can do and make enormous change. You know, you've just got to figure out how to do it, you know, more than anything. And I guess have a bit of guts and courage to make it happen.
What was your journey into Microsoft?
So DP manager, if you like, ran a company called Paxos Services, which was the largest HP IBM reseller through the 80s. Had a company myself in computer services and in print software, actually, for a few years. Went on to be the country manager in New Zealand for an Australian software company called Masterpack at the time, and fell into then, or they bought on CRM software, which was completely unknown at that time. And I loved that. I loved the fact that you could have instantly responsive type software or solutions to customer needs. And really, I'd like to think, I was pretty instrumental at that time. I ran this company called Pivotal, which is a Canadian software company for Asia Pacific. And unbeknown to me earlier on, we actually did best worldwide, our region did. And we really, I think, changed the landscape when it came to CRM software. So that was incredible. From a fun standpoint, it was a huge amount of fun, but also from a game-changing perspective in software, but also in business and the way in which businesses could integrate, not just, as you called it, boring old kind of accounting kind of stuff, but more entrepreneurial, more customer-centric type solutions. And then, I think I had a bit of a reputation for being able to grow companies and in the market, and came on into Microsoft when it had some challenges, certainly. And we had a great time, really figuring out, with a 98% Windows market domination, how do you grow the country in terms of revenue and performance, and also in terms of customer satisfaction. So one of the key things for me is you've got to look after your customer, in every business, and it doesn't matter who you talk to, who's worked with me, whether it be on a board or inside an organization, they'll all tell you that I have to have what I call a love the customer strategy. And, I remember a time at Microsoft when, we had a letter from this older gentleman, and actually the tone of the letter and everything, I picked up the phone and I rang him and he just couldn't believe it, and I just think, it's that kind of thing that makes a difference. So did that for a couple of years and then went on to work with Mark Franklin and a lady called Joanna Silver on behalf of the Stock Exchange to set up a company, an exchange in carbon trading when the emissions trading scheme first came out in New Zealand, right in the early days of understanding of climate change. And at that time, I was on the board of NIWA, and that was, again, that was lots of fun, really business orientated, really do good at mass scale. We made a big difference out into the communities in some of the poorer regions, particularly around Brazil, and also started to stimulate some conversation about how we could use what I'd call a carrot approach as opposed to a stick approach when it comes to environmentally from a sustainability standpoint, but financial incentives for doing the right thing. And that, unfortunately, in business often is what stimulates, their change, to doing something that potentially they may not have otherwise thought of doing.
And so that kind of idea of building things with impact and getting into governance. So coming out of Microsoft, huge CEO role, and out of the emissions trading register idea, really managing big things at scale, and then into governance. Tell me about some of those board roles across things like ATEED and around the rollout of technology to schools and some of the interesting parts of those projects.
Mm-hmm. Sure. So why don't we start with Network for Learning, or NFRL? So a Crown company incorporated by the government in July 2012, and I came on as the inaugural chair for that organisation, and we had an amazing board, and I think it's interesting, actually, the more you're in business and the more you're around, I think the more you know you don't know and the more you've got to learn. And it was actually at the time when, and the name completely escapes me, the payroll software challenges at in education. And one of the key things that we felt around the board table was, you know, we were not going to be an IT project that was going to fail. We were going to be an IT project that really was going to stand out. And interestingly enough, it never actually got a huge amount of airtime from a media standpoint. And I guess that's because it was successful. Mm-hmm. So we rolled out to, to every school in New Zealand a year ahead of plan, $211 million under budget. The goal of that organisation really was to start the ball rolling in every school and transform every school in New Zealand to be technology based. Which is no mean feat, and it also leveraged the investment the government had made in ultra-fast broadband. So basically what you've got now is every, 2,532 schools or thereabouts have a high-speed commercial-grade internet connection that's managed, which means that it's safe for the kids. So we blocked, on average 85 million viruses a month, process about 1.4 petabytes of data, block about 34,000 ransomware hits every month. So this is it sounds a bit detailed and it sounds a bit crazy, but actually keeping the kids safe from a cybersecurity standpoint is very important, and also giving kids the ability to learn and grow and leverage technology, because that's after all what the world is about, and most of them know that, and then some. So how do we integrate that whole schooling system, the whole education system into the technology into the schooling system? And I think that NFRAL has really done that. So we did have a love the customer strategy as well, and that really helped. I think that, and this is Helen's opinion, not necessarily the board's opinion, but I think actually the schools really appreciated the fact that there was someone to talk to, that we actually, it was really important from my perspective that every school was visited, and everybody looked at us and said we were crazy, because why would we go and visit every school to roll this out? But actually, I think that's what made us successful, or helped make us successful. Every school was able to talk with different, with somebody about face to face. So even though it was a tech business, it had very much a human face on it. And I think that's really important in technology. It's all very well to have great tech and great software and great hardware or whatever, and manage cybersecurity and do, everything that you need to do. But I think actually having the human factor being integrated is really critical. So it's a little bit on network for learning, on ATEED. ATEED's an incredible organisation. So I'd like to say it's a tiny CCO, but it's really the gel of Auckland and the way in which we develop and grow. And I know that there's been some criticism about, for example, the growth of Auckland from a population standpoint. But, I think, New Zealanders and Aucklanders have to figure out whether we really want to have a growing, thriving, economic, performing society, or we don't. We kind of, as Kiwis, want our cake and eat it too. And I think what ATEED's done phenomenally well is with a small amount of funding, is really leverage foreign investment, leverage and integrate, international organisations coming into the city, really focus on talent and skills in the country, and how do we really help drive that through. And I'm delighted to see so many different activities, in the city today, where all these different organisations are contributing, because it's not a one man, one organisation type of band, or you've got to have everybody working together. So doing that, and then obviously leveraging events as well, because events does so many great things for a city, as I think we all know, and whether it be a sporting event or a cultural event, because one, from an internal Auckland standpoint, you know, from a citizen standpoint, but also from a reputational perspective. And one of the things, you know, and woe betide anyone who talks about brand, but actually the identity of Auckland and what we stand for is critical for us. It's critical for us as we are now, but also critical in the way in which we communicate out into the world, based on what it is that you know Auckland and Aucklanders want. You know, do we want a same old, same old? Do we want our you know, our batch and BMW, as everyone says, or do we just want to, or do we really want to stimulate growth and stand out and have a great reputation?
Yeah,
out
absolutely. Yeah, your brand is what you do. So if we want to be known for interesting things, we have to have a whole bunch of interesting things happening here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for sure.
And having come from, these large roles, worked very hard to get to the top of some big organizations, and then being able to, as a chair and as a board member, contribute to, you know, very significant projects. What dragged you back in to a startup, and especially one with a point to prove? And it seems mm-hmm. remarkable to me that in 2018 there's still the stigma to battle around pads and tampons, mm-hmm. and also the dangerous, potentially dangerous materials, the luxury mm-hmm. taxes. Yeah. You know, to come back into a struggle, a movement, after having been in such a position of influence.
Okay, so does at scale does good. You know, two most important things, and also the bigger the better, as far as I'm concerned. You know, if we can drive the biggest change that we possibly can and have the biggest impact, then that's what excites me. You know, that's what stimulates me and gets me out of bed in the morning. And you're absolutely right. You know, the fact that there's still this general stigma around the fact that women get periods is crazy. You know, we talk quite openly, and it's really interesting being here in the US too, you know, talk about guns and sex and drugs and things, but don't talk about periods. Half the population for half our lives get a period. Fact. You know, it's a gift for us, because that's what means that we can actually have babies, and yet we don't talk about it, which is completely ridiculous. So yes, you know, we certainly have an opportunity to change that and make it normal and make it fun. And actually, you know, it's actually okay. We do talk about breast cancer and safe sex and everything else. Why don't we talk about periods as well? So absolutely on that front, really interesting in terms of governments around the world, you know, taking taxes away. You know, I think the jury's out, you know, in most places, you know, where do you start, where do you stop, you know, fruit, vegetables, you know, what's important. I think what is important, of course, though, is that that every woman deserves to have access to good product. And you're absolutely right, 99% still of the market worldwide in feminine hygiene is made of plastic. And we have at OI, so we call ourselves OI, which is OI, attracts attention. And then organic initiative is the answer. It's the solution. So that's how the kind of the brand strategy, if you like, works. And so our view is that every woman deserves a healthy product. You know, we do want to help when it comes to taking period poverty away, and we work with some great organisations to help make that happen. So there's a great organisation, Wellington, run by two young women called Dignity, which provides product into corporates, and the profits go to support girls who can't go to who don't go to school because they don't have access to product. Kids can do a huge amount of wonderful work, and so we work with them as well in the provision of product, and then doing a similar kind of thing over here in the US as well. So I think supporting that is really important. But equally important is that most, actually a growing number, I was going to say most women don't know, or most people don't know, but actually a growing number of people do know now that feminine hygiene products, conventional products, are made from plastic-based materials. full of toxins and chemicals, arguably, minimal amount, but we use these products for 35, 40 years and we use them for a long time and we use them in the hottest part of our bodies. You know, we don't put plastic in our microwave, but we, you know, we put plastic in our hottest parts of our bodies. So our mission is to take plastic out of hygiene products, starting with feminine hygiene. We launched in New Zealand exactly 3 years ago. We're in pretty much every store in the country, Pack and Save New World, just gone into the warehouse, a huge number of Four Squares, some great organic shops, Common Sense Organics, and a whole range of different stores. So that's pretty exciting, and we're on a mission, and we're in growth.
What stage are you at now with international expansion, and is the opportunity you know with 99% of the market with the synthetic products, you know, is there this enormous opportunity to globally scale the product?
Of course, half the population, half our lives. So in the US, for example, the market here is $2.7 billion. About 65% of that is one company has market share of that. There is a growing awareness of the need to think more healthily, healthy for us, but also healthy from a world standpoint. And we unashamedly support and get on the same wagon as all these. Let's remove plastic. So we say, let's take plastic out of supermarkets, from a bag standpoint, et cetera. Let's take plastic out of straws. What about plastic in our bodies? And so we really are on a journey to help make that happen. So in terms of our international expansion, I've pretty much moved to the US and setting up the business here. It's growing very quickly, and we're really excited about the stage that we're at. And then softly, if you like, into Asia. And then we've got a little bit going on in other parts of the world as well. So New Zealand start. Done very well. We're the fastest growing leading fem hygiene product. We really are hitting up against the major players now, which is fantastic. If you read the AC Nielsen reports, you will see that it's public information. So that's pretty exciting for us. A small company, we've only been around for a handful of years.
And radically transparent at every part as well. So from using bioplastic instead of plastic for places that you need wraps, mm-hmm. through to the organic product. And tell us a little bit about that, because that also means there's no pesticides in the cotton as mm-hmm. well, but also mm-hmm. the lives of the farmers are probably better, mm-hmm. as cotton is actually a very problematic crop.
Mm-hmm. For sure. So all of our products are if you can see, 100% organic cotton. And they're made to be both biodegradable and healthy from a female standpoint. We can trace, based on the lot numbers on the box, we can trace all the way back to the cotton farm, the bale. So complete transparency on that front. All the ink on the boxes, it's vegetable ink. So we've really tried to be very in every which way we can, and I think it's important to know that that when you have a business like ours, do we bring out other products? So we brought out a menstrual cup, for example. Now it's made of medical grade TPE. It's not biodegradable, and around the board table we debate high and low. Should we be doing this or shouldn't we be doing this? So what did we do? We found the best possible material we could. It's recyclable. We know that we are removing plastic pads and tampons out of the market by women using these, and they use those typically for years. And so we did bring out this product, which is a menstrual cup, reusable, recyclable, used for years. Don't need tampons, pads. And again, we wondered whether we had a, you know, whether we were going to jeopardize our core brand, which is, you know, organic cotton, tampons, pads, liners. But actually the opposite's true. And I think that that organic initiative is about doing the best we possibly can with everything that we possibly can do. And we'll continue to do that, you know, as we roll out, you know, our product roadmap. And, you know, where we're at is just the beginning, you know, literally both product-wise, client-wise, customer-wise and market-wise.
It, it seems, you know, remarkable that there is the opportunity there, but it must be wonderful. You know, how does it feel to be able to have that massive wave ahead of you?
Oh, it's so exciting! Like the opportunities are endless, and you know it's. I hope nobody takes this the wrong way, but it's a little bit like a game, right? Business is like a game. So you have this big, huge world, and you have any number of things that you could possibly do, and so where do you put your time and effort and focus, and and what is the potential? So how do you then figure that out? Where's your biggest bang for buck? You know, how do you penetrate the market in the fastest possible way? How do you do good at mass scale? How do you tap into the mindset? You know, and feminine hygiene, for example, it's a really, really loyal category. You know, women run into the in New Zealand, they buy mostly in supermarkets. Here it's in drugstores and mass market. Walmart, Target, etc. They run in and they grab what they've always grabbed, you know, something they trust, something their mothers used. You know, how do you then have this market conversion? So that then becomes, you know, this this brand and marketing challenge. You know, how do you do that and do it really effectively, and how do you do that fast? So it's really exciting. You know, I think that, well, I'd like to think OI will be an organisation that, you know, people should sit up and take note. But I think it's a choice. You know, we all have a choice in terms of what we do, what we use. And if we can help impact that choice and do good, you know, do good for the world and do good for people, then that's really incredible. I have to go in a sec.
Yes.
Should I finish just with one little story that so I met one of the buyers of one of the biggest I'm not going to say who it is, but one of the biggest chain stores here in the US, and then I subsequently met her, followed up with her, and I met her at a show, and we had a 20 minute one-on-one meeting, and I went and met her in her offices, walked into her office, and she said, "I'm so excited," and I went, "Oh, it's fantastic, you know, that's really great." And I said, you know, basically, "Tell me more." And she said, "You know, every time I go to these shows and I have to come back and think about how I justify my my attendance, because it's time and it's cost, you know, et cetera." And she said, "But this time I came back, and when my boss said to me, 'How was the show?' I said to him, 'I found the innovation in feminine hygiene.'" And that's what she said. So that's pretty cool. Kiwi company, you know, it's fun.
Ah, that's so exciting. Well, thank you so much for taking the time to chat to us today. Helen Robinson of OI, the Organic Initiative, available everywhere in New Zealand and soon everywhere around the world.
Thanks so much, Simon. Okay. Take care.
Thanks for sharing your story. Cheers.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.
Cool. So thank you very much also to Tina Tiller for producing. And yeah, apologies for the sound quality changes there on a line from America. And thank you for having us on.
You've been listening to Business is Boring, presented by Simon Pound. And brought to you by The Spinoff and Callaghan Innovation.
From the Spinoff Podcast Network, that was Business is Boring, brought to you by SparkLab. Make sure you're following Business is Boring wherever you get your podcasts. And for more information on SparkLab, visit sparklab.co.nz.
Ready to rediscover the joys of cycling?
With over 300 kilometres of cycle paths across Tāmaki Makaurau, jumping on your bike and going for a ride is such a fun way to discover the city from a different perspective. Cycling is getting more and more popular across Auckland, so now's a great time to join the hype and give cycling a go. Head to at.govt/cycling to find your nearest cycleway today. The Spinoff Podcast Network.